Trudge the Road on BCTV.
Underwritten by the Care and Treatment Centers.
If drugs or alcohol are an issue in your life,
or the life of someone you love,
we're here to offer insight into the disease of addiction.
Trudge the Road.
Welcome to Trudge the Road. We're your hosts. I'm Rich, a recovered drug addict.
My name is Jerry, and I'm a sober alcoholic.
Well, we've got a lot of things to cover today, but before we get to that, a couple of programming notes. We do have a Facebook page. It's Trudge the Road Radio. We have a website, trudgetheroadradio.com. We've got a Twitter account. We're also on iTunes. And you can find all this just by going to trudgetheroadradio.com, our website, which will disperse you into the social media world, and you can find all the stuff that we got going on. We base this TV show on a radio show that we do, which is called, obviously, Trudge the Road. And there's a reason we do that, Jerry. Why do we do what we do?
Trudge the Road is a radio program, as is this television show, dedicated to folks like ourselves who suffer from the disease of addiction, but every bit as important are family members and friends. You suffer tremendously. It's hard to describe, hard to define. We do our best to understand, and our goal here is to answer the questions we know that you have to the best of our ability, and with the help of a power greater than ourselves, find some kind of a solution to this incredible dilemma, which is the disease of addiction.
All right, so on July 15th of this year.
Oh, congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much. I celebrated 15 years of sobriety. Thank you very much to you and the other person watching. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yeah, it's been an incredible journey from where I was. Pitiful, incomprehensible demoralization, I think, is a great way to sum up exactly where I was a little over 15 years ago when I finally decided to set everything down and pay attention to the 12 steps, which had been present in my life for quite some time. I tried to quit a couple of other times, and you know how that worked out. It didn't. So I eventually finally sat down and started with the first step. I just surrendered.
You accepted that powerlessness.
I did. I surrendered for the first time because I wanted to fight it. Just like everybody who's an addict that you probably know will fight you on it. We'll find a million different ways to tell you that you're wrong, and that you don't know what you're talking about, and why don't you pay attention to your own life and quit worrying about mine? Because that's how we are. But anyways, 15 years ago, and thank you to everybody who's been a part of this journey. And Jerry, thank you very much. You've been a part of this journey for the last 10 years.
It's been an absolute honor.
We've got a couple of things to talk about, and we're going to start tonight with changing the social perception of the addict.
Yeah.
Topic.
It is my topic. And but first, just before, you know, because you hit that surrender thing, and I really need to emphasize to people that that's kind of where we as addicts have to be able to begin this journey into a life of clean and sobriety. And surrendering is just like, I'll use a Geneva Convention as an example. When a soldier at the time of war surrenders, he or she takes their weapon, puts it down, sits there, and waits for somebody to come tell him what to do. That's it. That's called an unconditional act. And that's what we ask you to do when you get to us, is take the drinks, take the drugs, put them down, find a seat, and listen to the suggestions that are offered to you and act upon them. And your journey will begin on this, and it's a journey of absolute magnificent proportion. But back to the topic of mine, which is the change of social, or if you will, cultural perception about the addict, and I'm going to be specific about our community, not just Berks County, but also Lancaster and Dolphin County, and I'm going to use, for example, the police. The police have changed their perception on the way that they deal with the addict, and have come to the conclusion that the punitive measures that we've used for so many years have had little to no success, because it's a continual cycle of arresting and rearresting, and the problem continues to get worse. They see this. They've all been given Narcanon, for example, and I think that was a major step, and that is a substance that is used to bring somebody back who is overdosed. And in this community alone, it saved a number of lives. And we're incredibly grateful for the police department to learn and to be brave enough to carry that around and deal with an addict as an addict should be dealt with. An addict is not a criminal. An addict or an alcoholic is an extremely sick person. And it goes back to the war on drugs. And we're all familiar with the war on drugs. It's 50 years old now and has cost billions and billions and billions of dollars.
And where are we today?
The drugs are bigger than ever before. They are stronger than ever before. They are cheaper than ever before. They are more plentiful than ever before.
So I think it's safe to say that the war on drugs has been a failure.
The war on drugs is the biggest failure in our country's history. But, you know, it really isn't a failure because there never really was a war on drugs. There wasn't. There was a massive war on people, but not so on drugs. And hundreds of thousands of people, just like the two of us who easily could be behind bars, are behind bars or were behind bars, not because they were an addict, but because of the behavior mechanism which the disease manifests. This disease manifests itself behaviorally. And if you become addicted to drugs and alcohol, and we'll just use myself as an example, that's all it becomes is a life of drugs and alcohol. And that brings me to the second position or point I want to talk about. Who the addict is, and who the addict is before they get here. You have to understand that I had the disease of addiction way before I ever used the drugs or alcohol, and the behavior that matched it. This is a disease that has its own pathology that has been recognized as a disease, just like cancer or any disease of its nature, by the American Medical Association since 1955. The pathology of the disease really wasn't discovered until the 70s at Johns Hopkins University, but there definitely is a pathology, and there is no question that this is a disease that has a genetic overtone to it. Now, this can't be proven, but it's really pretty obvious if you're from a family of addicted people, and we both certainly are. There are more people than ourselves in our family who suffer from this disease, and it can be traced back a number of generations. So again, it's something I didn't ask for, that I was born with, that manifested itself behaviorally. And the truth of the matter is, once that I used, that painful life became normal and happy. And, you know, I'll give you, I think I may have done it on this program before, the example of how it worked for the first time, how alcohol really worked. And it wasn't hard for me to get a hold of alcohol. We're Irish Catholic family, and we owned a bar, the Shamrock. You'd have loved it because it opened at 6 o'clock in the morning. But anyway, the point was, stealing the alcohol wasn't bad. And I stole a brand called Yukon Jack, and there's probably people who are watching, and yourself certainly, who are familiar with this particular type of alcohol. I call it candy whiskey. It's extremely strong, but it's sweet. And again, at the time I'm 12 and a half years old, that's when I started to drink. And I stole the bottle, and my buddies, there was five of us all together, went out with this bottle of Yukon Jack and began to drink it. And they got, as 9 out of 10 people who were watching this program got, silly and goofy and kind of drunky. But I got okay. And the alcoholic absolutely knows exactly what I'm talking about. I'm obviously a baby boomer, and you know, it's a scary time now, but it was a scary time back then. It was the Cold War. You know, are those Russians going to shoot that bomb? Is it coming? They even went into our schools and showed us pictures of what happens when that nuclear bomb hits. It was terrifying, you know. And then to live in that world and to be raised by people who came out of the Depression. People who came out of the Depression had a continual fear of their financial security. And that was always the case. So in my mind, it was, you know, are we going to lose the bar? Is Daddy going to lose his job? Are these Russians coming? I can't pass math. I'm not going to make the football team. I can't. All of these things going through my head. As soon as that alcohol went into my system, all of that fear, all of that angst, all of that anxiety, all of those issues that are the component of the disease of addiction were gone. I was not drunk. I wasn't drunk at all. We're bodily.
You were just okay.
I was just okay.
And I think that it's important to also note that alcohol wasn't your problem. It was the solution to your problems.
Perfectly put.
And we're going to talk about that coming up next right here on Trudge the Road TV.
You're watching Trudge the Road on BCTV.
Underwritten by the Care and Treatment Centers.
More information and insight can be found at TrudgeTheRoadRadio.com.
Welcome back to Trudge the Road TV. It's been so long. I missed you. It's been about 30 seconds. When we last left, Jerry, we're talking about how you got when you first started drinking, when you were a young lad and everybody else got goofy and silly, and you got okay.
I was just absolutely all right. Alcohol instantly changes my perception of life. I'm taller, I'm handsome, I'm more clever, and you are much less threatening. That's the big part. It's that fear. That's the problem. It's the disease of fear, and drugs, you know, and alcohol are my solution. And for a while, you know, as it did for you, that solution worked. It gave me confidence. It gave me the ability to be able to communicate. It took away that wall of anxiety that prevented me from really involving myself in society. I became quite the little social butterfly, but I had to be under the influence of alcohol. Not necessarily drunk, but just enough to lower that level of fear.
To lubricate your
right.
mind.
But things do change, you know, and what happened with me is I continued to change and continue to use more. The behaviors started to change along with it, and those behaviors become worse and worse and worse and worse. And as we've talked about before, what happens is our ability to intellectually make a decision or participate in life whatsoever goes right out the window, and we deal with everything emotionally. In other words, both of us just based our decisions on how we felt instead of how we thought. Well, if you base your decisions on how you feel all the time, you're only going to base your decisions on trying to feel better. And when drugs and alcohol aren't in my system, I feel bad, so I've got to get drugs and alcohol. But because of this issue, I have a little trouble, should we say, maintaining employment, being in relationships, things of that nature. So again, my behavior changes, and I start to begin to do things, to act out in ways that would never even cross my mind had I not been in this very ill state, and specifically doing things like stealing. Let me share this one story. This girl and I borrowed this guy's car, and we had to move something. And,
you want to define borrow? Did you really borrow it?
Well, this is what happened, is that after we borrowed the car, I had one of those fits of like, I've got to clean up my life. I've got to change. I've got to get some money. I've got to stop living this way. This is absolutely crazy. And I had the answer, and I said, you know what we need to do? And she said, what? And I said, let's sell the car. and I remember her going, let's, you know. These are the old days of being able to, what they called, forge a pink slip. And I sold this guy's car. My car, I sold somebody else's car. But the rationalization process relieved me of the guilt and shame as long as the alcohol was in my system. I remember the call and his response. I'll never forget the way he said, you sold my car? And yes, I did. And then years later, when I made amends, and that's process of recovery, is we make amends. We don't go back and say we're sorry. We say we were wrong and do what we can to correct that amend. And I called him and told him I wanted to, you know, pay him for this car. And his voice was exactly the same. He goes, you want to pay me back for the car? You know? So that type of behavior becomes a bit of the norm, and it gets worse and worse and worse, and then we become really detached from society, and that begins with being attached the first time, you know, detaching from the family,
right.
Detaching from community, detaching from elements that you used to belong to. You know, you're not part of the bowling league anymore. You're not part of the football team. You don't play softball.
You isolate is what you do.
You begin to isolate, and the only normal world becomes the drunk world. And the fact of the matter, ladies and gentlemen, is both of us are sitting here in an abnormal state. We're clean and we're sober. And for us, that is abnormal. We are, for lack of a better term to use, machines that are built to drink. Normal for us is to be on drugs and alcohol. This is abnormal. We have had to learn another way of living, which deals with all of the issues that made us drink. And a lot of that goes back to the behavior or the emotional ramifications of the behavior, i.e. specifically guilt and shame. And both of us had a bag full of it.
Well, you talked about earlier the inability to maintain employment.
Yeah.
And I can tell you how sick I was at one time that I had lost a job. I was working in a pretty big market.
A six-figure job.
Yeah, it was six figures. I was working in Phoenix, and I had lost my job. And
directly as a result of your addiction.
Well, it played a pretty big role. Let's just say it was about 99%. And so, you know, I'd been working in a big market. And I'd been doing, you know, a pretty good job despite my addictions. And I got a few phone calls afterwards. I got calls from Wichita, Kansas, and a call from Boise, Idaho. People wanted to talk to me about coming to work for them. But after I would get off the phone with each one of these people, I would go to High Times, or I would call somebody in the area and try to scope out the dope situation, because there was no way I was going to move to a city without a connection.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the kind of sickness. Even though this had cost me, and I was a functioning addict for a real long time, this had cost me my gig, I couldn't get another gig unless I was able to continue the same behaviors. And when I couldn't find the answers that I was looking for, and I couldn't find the drugs that I was looking for, I just turned the job down.
Mm-hmm.
I ended up gone and living in the mountains for about a year and a half.
That's
what I did. But I had a giant duffel bag full of cash and a whole bunch of crystal meth, and I don't think I slept for a year.
The party was on.
Coming up, we want to talk a little bit about recovery and the spiritual path in which we take to get to that recovery. That's coming up next here on Trudge the Road TV.
You're watching Trudge the Road on BCTV, underwritten by the Karen Treatment Centers.
You can find more information and insight at trudgetheroadradio.com.
And you can find archived episodes of this show and past shows at bctv.org. Just search Trudge the Road in On Demand.
Trudge the Road.
Welcome back to Trudge the Road TV. We're your hosts. I'm Rich, a recovered drug addict.
My name is Jerry, and I'm a sober alcoholic.
We're talking a little bit about, our past and, of course, the addict and what happens when the addict uses. We've talked about the perceptions, the social perceptions. They're changing. And, you know, when you look at addiction today, it is huge. I mean, it is the number one health crisis going on in America today. And back when, I got to say, you know, when I was a kid, we drank and we smoked weed. But kids today, it seems to be more heroin and opiates going on today than I can recall in my entire lifetime.
Well, it is. It's worse than any time in the history of our country. And it's in the epidemic stage, especially, you know, in the area that we're at, there is an opiate epidemic. It's a crisis. Law enforcement is completely aware of it and doing everything they can, and now trying to deal with it in a little bit more positive of a notion. To incarcerate somebody and take this very sick person and throw punitive damages at them, you, the American taxpayer, pays quadruple the amount, if you would, if we got them treatment. And if we get them treatment and we get them into the recovering community, they're not going to act out again. We're living proof of that. Both of us have been to jail. Both of us have done time as a direct result of our disease. And what good did that do in stopping us? Absolutely not.
Oh, no, I was jonesing the minute I got out. I was, I'm going to go find some drugs.
Because it's because we never blame, you were 100% correct when you talked about the perception. We absolutely never blame the drug or the alcohol for being a problem, because there's this massive level. It's either the best or it's the absolute worst. I have this old car one time, and I hated this car. It was just this nasty old car. And I remember going out in the morning, and you'd open the door to make that squeaking noise because it needed the oil shot down there. Get inside and start it up, and five of the six cylinders would go. And I'd just hate that car and really hate you because you had a nice car and you were going to a job and your life was together. And I just was full of anger and spite. And this car was the worst. And then I'd take that car and I'd get it into drive, and I'd drive it over to the bar. And then I'd go into the bar and drink whiskey for 45 minutes, for an hour, not a long period of time. Now, that's how I walked in, this angry, mad, discontented individual. 45 minutes of drinking whiskey, and I walk out of the bar. This is the God honest truth. I look at that exact same car and go, that's a 1972 Mercury Comet. That's a classic, you know.
And you
get inside that car, instead of, you know, cigarette smell and an old whiskey, new car smell. And I fire that thing up, boom, and say, Detroit doesn't make them like this anymore. Put that thing in drive and take off. As you can see, I've had a complete and total perceptual change that was chemically induced, that went from A to Z in 45 minutes. That's what alcohol does. But I would rather be that person who was happy and having a wonderful time in this fabulous classic automobile driving down the highway than that miserable, I've lost out on life and life has cheated me out of everything type of person who showed up at the bar. So you can see how obviously I want to change the way that I feel so that I'm taller, so that I'm clever, so that I'm handsome, and the most important thing, you are much less threatening. And
now, as you went down this path, you had to find your way to this, to the recovery.
I did, and there's not a lot of time to explain it, but I'm gonna use somebody else's analogy of what happened to me and how I was rescued, you know, from this disease, if you will. When I was in graduate school, his name is David Friedenthal. He was he's not an alcoholic, he's not a drug addict, but he chaired the Department of Divinity and Religion at the university that I went to, and dealt with people who were really just on the doctoral level, so I didn't have him as a tutor. I knew who he was, and his reputation was absolutely impeccable. He's the smartest man I've ever met. He's a Rhodes Scholar. He speaks three or four languages. I don't know how many, two, three PhDs. He's brilliant, and he's a rabbi. Unbelievable man. But I didn't know him. And then one Sunday night, I went to this Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. The 11-step group is what they've called in Louisville, Kentucky. And it was a spiritual meeting. And the path of recovery via the 12 steps is a spiritual path, not religious, spiritual. And I walked in there, and there was Rabbi Friedenthal sitting there. Now, I would never have the nerve to walk up to him on campus, but here on my turf, pal, this is an AA meeting. I went up to him, and I said, you know, doctor, I had no idea that you were an alcoholic. And he said to me, I've never had a drink in my life outside of ceremonial wine. And I, you know, had to ask the obvious question, what are you doing here? And his response was, he said, I believe that God is in the temple. I believe that God is in the cathedral. I believe that God is in the mosque. But I know that God is in Alcoholics Anonymous because I hear him out loud. And that's what happens within the meetings of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's a spiritual inspiration. We're alcoholics and drug addicts. How are we going to get our instructions on how to help the next guy unless we hear him out loud? And he wouldn't say anything, but would come and hear things that in this brilliant man's mind were of a level of spirituality that could only be from a power greater than ourselves, however you may want to define that. And he refers to our culture, the people in recovery, as the passengers of lifeboat number 9. And it's a true story. It happened a little over 100 years ago when the Titanic hit the iceberg and sank. Not nearly as many people had to drown. The reason was the lifeboats weren't full. They're only maybe a quarter full, and people were just trying to get out of there. It's called the fight or flight mechanism, and I understand completely. A few people get in this boat, and they see this massive tanker coming over on them, and it's go, 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 let's get out of here.
Right.
Save your life. It's a natural response, as it was for the passengers of lifeboat number 9, and this is a historical fact. There were 11 people on a boat that held, I can't remember if it was 20 or 30, this lifeboat, but bang, they took off. Now, for some reason, and I won't be able to find out until I get to heaven, hopefully, and ask them, these 11 people who did not know each other made the conscious decision to turn around and go back. And they did, and it's the sea is black, there's dark, they can't see, it's freezing, the waves are just splashing up everywhere, and they just started rowing back to the Titanic, and the only thing they had were their audio senses left. They could hear, and they listened for people in the water screaming, help me, help me, help me, help me, and they roll up to that person, and before they went down, grabbed them, pull them into the boat, listen for the next person to scream, roll the boat up to them, grab them, pull them into the boat, listen to the next, and they kept doing that and doing that and doing that. And it was brought to the attention of me by this wonderful rabbi. That's exactly what happened to me. I was going down for the third time. I was through. I was done. And then out of nowhere, these group of people came and pulled me out of the water into this boat of recovery and have never asked for anything in return, except that now that I'm a passenger, that I do my part in pulling people into the boat. And that's what we're trying to do here right now. And really, how does that define these people who were drunks, these people who were addicts, these people who were hookers, these people who were thieves, these people who were liars? How does that really describe them? Somebody who would do that? Courageous certainly comes to mind. Selfless absolutely comes to mind. Kindness comes to mind. Humility comes to mind. Those are the people, and those are their characteristics in the recovering community. That's what we get out of recovery. That is who we become. We become kind, generous, humble people who are dedicated really to only one thing in life. I know what my purpose is in life. My purpose in life is not to be a broadcaster. I have that job. As a job, I have to pay bills. But my purpose in life is to help another alcoholic or a drug addict. That's his purpose in life. That is what we do, and that's what we spend our time doing. Why do we do that? Because we were those persons, those people in the water who out of nowhere, these complete strangers pulled us in and saved our lives. And have asked for nothing in return except that we return the favor. And that's what we do on a day-to-day basis. People who walk into the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous, people whom we meet in treatment centers, people who watch our DVDs, people who watch this television show or listen to us on the radio, you're part of the solution. It doesn't happen just like that. There's a lot of misinformation out there. There's a lot of hate, if you will. There's a lot of stereotype, and none of it is true. Alcoholics and drug addicts are suffering from a disease. And you know, I'm going to tell you, this is just, in my opinion, it has nothing to do with recovery. It's the cancer of the soul. You know, it's an illness of body, mind, and soul. And the reason I bring that up is just that reason that the rabbi gave about the passengers of lifeboat number 9. The 12 steps that we use to become healthy again are spiritually based. There is a point where you have to come to an understanding that there is a power greater than yourself. Whatever definition of God is for you is up to you within the recovering community. There is no religious practice. We certainly have nothing against religion, 100% for it. Our founder believed this, whatever religion you showed up at, you should go back to and be better at, because now you've got this gift of spirituality. And I think what it gives to us and to our culture really is an open porthole of communication to this power, which is love. It is absolute. God wants, he loves you. That's his will for you, is to be happy, joyous, and free. And we have that porthole of communication to be able to receive these instructions, this guidance, be able to share it with someone. And when you see someone getting better, when you see someone get it, if you will, in their life of misery, pain, and horror, comes to an end, it's not that you did anything except had a front row seat for what is what we know today, a miracle.
All right. Thank you, Jerry. And this is Trudge the Road, and you can visit our website at trudgetheroadradio.com and get more nuggets of wisdom. and you can listen to our radio show.
Please
which,
do.
We have a whole pant load of them up on the YouTubes and also iTunes. You can download. Just search for Trudge the Road Radio. For Jerry, I'm Rich. This is Trudge the Road on BC TV.
Trudge the Road
on BC TV
is underwritten by the Karen Treatment Centers. For more information, find us at trudgetheroadradio.com. Until next month,
we shall be with you in the fellowship of the Spirit.
And you will surely meet some of us as you trudge the road of happy destiny.
Trudge the Road.